الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. وإن شاء الله تعالى gonna go into our series on علوم القرآن. The sciences pertaining to the Qur'an. Today, inshaAllah ta'ala, the lesson is going to be like this. This is the layout. Remember at the beginning when we started this series, what did we say? This series we're going to study two things, right? What was the first part? Ulum al-Qur'an, and the second was what? Ilm al-Tafsir, right? صح? We finished Ulum al-Qur'an now. What are we starting today? Ilm al-Tafsir. So we're going to take التفسير في اللغة, in the language. What does it mean in the language? And what does it mean اصطلاحا? Number two, we're going to الحديث عن نشأة التفسير. And the tatawwur in which it is done, the evolving and the formation, we're going to speak about it في مراحل ثلاثة. We're going to speak about it in three stages. The first one is في عهد النبي. The second one is في عهد الصحابة. And the third one is في عهد التابعين. الحديث عن نشأة التفسير. And the way that we're going to be speaking about it regarding the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is نماذج النبوية في التفسير. And second point is ما مقدار ما فسره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. When it comes to the Sahabas, we're going to be speaking about three points, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is ما هي الأصول والركائز. والركائز التي قام عليها منهج الصحابة. من هم علماء التفسير في الصحابة. Here we're going to be speaking about three things. من هو التابعي. معنى تفسير التابعي. Number three is هل تفسير التابعي حجة. That's what we're going to speak about today, inshallah ta'ala. Let me go over it with you all. First point, inshallah ta'ala, is التفسير في اللغة. What does tafsir mean in the Arabic language? What does it mean? What does tafsir mean? This word, tafsir, what does it mean in the Arabic language? What does it mean according to the scholars? What do the scholars mean by التفسير? Number two, We're going to be speaking about Nash'at al-Tafsir, how Tafsir came about and the evolving in which it went through. And we're going to divide that into how many stages? 3 stages. The first stage is the Prophet's time, and 2 points I'm going to focus on. Examples of the Prophet doing Tafsir. And number 2 is مَا مِقْدَارُ مَا فَسَّرَهُ النَّبِيِّ. Did the Prophet do Tafsir of the whole Qur'an, or did he do Tafsir some of the Qur'an? And the discussions regarding that. Those are 2 points. Number 2, what are the pillars and the foundation? مَا هِيَ الْأُصُولُ وَالرَّكَائِزُ أَلَّتِي قَامَ عَلَيْهَا مَنْهَجُ الصَّحَابَةِ. What was the methodology of the companions when it came to Tafsir? 2, مَنْ هُمْ عُلَمَاءِ التَّفْسِيرِ فِي الصَّحَابَةِ. Who were the scholars of Tafsir from amongst the companions? Or were they all Mufassirin? Those are 2 points. As for the timing of the companion Tabi'een, we're going to speak about it in 3 ways. Who are the Tabi'een? What does the Tafsir of the Tabi'een actually mean? 3, is the Tafsir of the Tabi'een a proof? Can we use it? Can we say that the Tabi'een explains this ayah like this? Can we use it as a proof? Let's start with the first one, inshaAllah ta'ala, which is at-tafsiru fi al-lugha. Tafsir in the Arabic language. It means al-ibanatu wal-kashf. In the language, tafsir means al-ibana wal-kashf. It means to bring something clear, make something clear. That's what tafsir means in the language. Al-ibana. Al-ibana wal-kashf. It is to unveil something. It is to clarify something. That's what it means in the language. What does it mean istilahan? What does tafsir mean technically? What does it mean? It is العلم knowledge الذي يعنى, which gives importance to ببيان, in clarifying معاني, the meaning of القرآن الكريم. So it is العلم, a science الذي يعنى in it, importance is given to understanding the meaning of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. That's what it means, التفسير, اصطلاحا, technically. That is the technical meaning. Now we're going to go into tafsir and the historical formation of tafsir. It's 3 stages in which it went through. What's the first stage? The time of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Messenger was alive, he would explain the verses in the Quran. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. Namadij means what? Examples, prophetic examples of tafsir, meaning the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do tafsir of ayat alayhi salatu wa salam. An example for that is when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recited وَهُوَ يَخْطُبُ فِي الْمِنْبَرِ, while he was on the pulpit. The Prophet was on the pulpit giving khutbah to Jum'ah, and what did he recite? He recited the ayah وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْرِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَ اللَّهِ. So he read this ayah, وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. Prepare against the enemies. What do you prepare against them? وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ. قوة, strength. Here the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explained for us what it means in the ayah قوة. What kind of قوة do we need to prepare? And the Prophet said, أَلَا إِنَّ الْقُوَّةَ الرَّمِي. Verily, the strength here means archery, swords, guns today, whatever. So the ayah explained the meaning of what? The word? Al-Quwwah, what it means. Who explained it? Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another example is the ayah, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. The Sahabas, they read this ayah, and the ayah says that whoever from amongst you that does not do oppression, what is he going to get? He's going to get safety. And he's going to get what? Guidance. So the Sahabas, they said, أَيُّنَا لَمْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ. Who is from amongst us who hasn't oppressed himself? Who hasn't wronged? Because I said the one who doesn't oppress. Who from amongst us has not oppressed ever? And then the Prophet corrected the meaning of oppression here. What did he say the oppression he has meant by? Yeah? الشرك. He read the other ayah for them. إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. That shirk is a great oppression. Shirk is a what? It's a great form of oppression. So he explained it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is an example of tafsir al-nabawiyyah. Here's the question now. Did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam do tafsir of the whole entire Quran and open it and say, ayah this means this, ayah this means this, ayah this means this, ayah this means this? Did the Prophet explain the Quran? This question is ambiguous. If a person says to you, did the Prophet explain the Quran? The answer is yes and a no. Yes, in the sense, if you mean, did he explain the Quran qawlan, verbally, and gave ta'liq on every verse, then yes, no, he didn't. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't do that. He didn't do that for every verse. He didn't sit down and say, this ayah, it means this, and this is what it's meant by it, and this is what it's meant by it. He did it for some verses, but not all of it. And what about the other verses? The other verses, he explained it through his actions. The 23 years that he was amongst them was a tafsir of the Quran. Are we all together, brothers? The way he did things, the way he carried himself, was an explanation for the Quran. Does that make sense, brothers? So we say yes, he did do tafsir of the whole Quran, and no, he didn't, because he didn't explain it word for word. Does that make sense? And since the companions saw his doings, they knew that is what the ayah means. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Sahih? Like for example, the ayah, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Did the Prophet do tafsir of that ayah? We'll say yes. He went Hajj and he said to the people, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكُمْ. That's the tafsir of what? The ayah, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Did the Prophet do tafsir of this ayah? Yes, he did. How? He prayed and he taught them how to pray. So this is the response to this question. Now we're going to move on to the companions. We're going to move on to the what? Companions. First point, what are the foundations and the pillars in which the companions' tafsir stood on? What methodology did the Sahabas take to do tafsir? Are we all together, brothers? We'll say number one. Write this down. This is the methodology that the companions took to do tafsir of the Quran. Number one, the methodology that the Sahabas took, number one, is tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'an. They explained an ayah with another ayah. That was their methodology. So if there was a verse, they would try to find another verse that clarifies it. Are we all together, brothers? And I gave an example for that, which is what? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ. The dhulm here has been explained somewhere else in the Qur'an, which is what? إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. The Qur'an explaining. There's a scholar who wrote a book in doing that to the Qur'an. Does anyone know which scholar that is? Huh? Muhammad al-Amin al-Shankiti's tafsir is called Al-Adwa'u al-Bayan. It's called Al-Adwa'u al-Bayan. Fi إيضاح القرآن بالقرآن. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shankiti's kitab Al-Adwa'u al-Bayan is the tafsir of the Quran with the Quran. Are we all together, brothers? I'm growing old, brothers. I'm growing old. It's called Al-Adwa. No, it's not Al. Sorry, I don't know why I put Alif Al-Lam in front of it. It's not Al-Adwa. It's just Adwa. It's Adwa Ul-Bayan. Take the Alif Al-Lam out of it and write Adwa Ul-Bayan. Fi إيضاح القرآن بالقرآن. If I don't finish the name off, you just have to do a little more research, go home and just finish off the name. So that book is very good. Try to buy it. Muhammad Amin al-Shankiti, he explains an ayah with another ayah. He does that a lot, rahimahullahu ta'ala, very well. Even that the scholars mention, oh, that's the reality, that he really, a lot of his work on Adwa al-Bayan is actually taken from the tafsir of Qurtubi. It's a, he depended on it. Okay, the second one is Tafsir al-Qur'ani bis-sunnati as-sahiha. Number two is Tafsir of the Qur'an based on the what? The sunnah. The sunnah explains it. Number three, it's At-Tafsir bil-Ijtihad. Tafsir of the Qur'an based on Ijtihad. What is Ijtihad? Independent reasoning. So they will do their own, they will look at the ayah and they will do ijtihad. Does that make sense, brothers? They will do ijtihad, they will look at the ayah. How would they do ijtihad? Does anyone know? They would use the Arabic language. They would use what? The ijtihad here is the Arabic language. Imagine today, what order did we mention the tafsir is done? How is it done? Al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an. If you can't find it, then you go for Qur'an. If you can't find it, then you go for what? Imagine who, the person whose tafsir is based on the Arabic language, all of it. And he himself admits that he doesn't know the sunnah. He says, I don't even know the sunnah. Is that a mufassir? Is he doing tafsir of the Qur'an? What is he explaining to the people? If he doesn't know her, the sunnah. Ajib. The Quran, it's this order. Allah knows what he's saying more than anybody else. So you find it somewhere else in the Quran. That's what Allah says in many places. He says, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Wattariq, hey? What did he say after that? What's the ayah? Hey? Wattariq? Wama adraka mattariq, hey? And then Tariq means what? Al-Najm al-Thaqib. Allah explained it. He knows it better than you what he means by it. That's one way. The second one is, who knows the Quran more than us? Nabiullah Muhammad. Number three, when we say the Arabic language, do we mean that we look at a person who now study the Arabic language, the understanding he took from the verse, or are we looking at the Arabic language that the Sahabas understood? Which one? Sahabas one. The Arabic got tainted. It got changed. Are we all together, brothers? Today, if I say to you, this is makruh, what do you understand from makruh, brothers? That is what? The Quran doesn't use the word makruh as disliked. It uses as what? Haram. You see, it's changed for you. Allah says, he talks about وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. Don't come close to zina. Allah talks about وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ. Don't kill your children. And then after all of that, what does he say? كُلُّ ذَلِكَ كَانَ سَيِّئُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ مَكْرُوهَا. All of that to your Lord is makruh. Is killing makruh. Disliked. Is zina makruh, disliked? Yeah? Is it? No, it's not. It's haram. Then the terms have become different as time evolved. The Arabic that you're reading has changed from when it was the time of the companions. The poet, he said, لَسْتُ بِنَحْوِيٍّ يَلُوكُ لِسَانَهُ. I'm not a grammarian where I have to think if this is a mubtada. Okay, I have to pay some raf'a on there. Is this khabar? A khabar is marfu'. Is this a maf'ulun bi? It's mansub. He said, لَسْتُ بِنَحْوِيٍّ. I'm not a grammarian where I have to look. I have to think when I want to pronounce it. وَلَكِنِّي سَلِيقِيٌّ أَقُولُ فَأُعْرِبُ. But I am an Arab. This is my language. When I say it, it's grammatically correct. That's how the Sahabas were. They were not thinking about the grammatical construction of the sentence. Are we all together, brothers? So that's how the manhaj, the path of the companions was when it came to tafsir. Now we're going to go to the tabi'een. Sorry, I have من هم علماء التفسير في الصحابة. Who are the scholars of the companions when it comes to tafsir? Number one, the خلفاء الأربعة, the four خلفاء الراشدين, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. No one's like these men. Who? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. These four, even though the Abu Bakr, the ayats that he gave tafsir on is very little in comparison to the rest, is because they were busy with what? The issue of the Khilafah. That's what preoccupied Abu Bakr's time. Like, no one knew the Quran more than him, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Are we all together? How do we know that? When the messenger was dying, who did he command to lead the people? Huh? And we know the famous hadith is فَلْيَأُمَّ الْقَوْمَ أَقْرَأُهُمْ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Let the one who knows the Quran the most lead the people. صح? And here the Prophet commanded who to lead. So what does that tell us? That Abu Bakr is the most knowledgeable man when it comes to the Quran رضي الله تعالى عنه. And then Umar comes. And then Uthman. And then who? Ali ibn Abi Talib. After them come Abdullah ibn Mas'ud comes. Are we all together? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, مَا مِنْ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا وَأَنَا أَعْلَمُ أَيْنَ نَزَلَتْ وَمَتَى نَزَلَتْ وَفِيمَا نَزَلَتْ وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ أَحَدًا أَعْلَمُ مِنِّي بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ تَقْطَعُ الْمَطَايَا مِنَ الْإِبِلِ لَرَكِبْتُ وَلَذَهَبْتُ إِلَيْهِ. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, I know every verse in the Quran, where it came down, who it came down, when it came down. And if I was to know anyone more knowledgeable than me in the Quran, in which I know I can go to him, I would take my riding beast and I'll go to that person. In other words, there is no one in the face of this earth today who knows the Quran more than me. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And that was true. Every single verse I can tell where it came down. What time? Are we all together, brothers? And then, Shaykh al-Islam Taymi has a benefit here, a very good benefit, which is, who is more knowledgeable in the tafsir, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud or Abdullah ibn Abbas? Who's, yeah? Who? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Hey, who else? Any other person? Yeah? Abdullah ibn Abbas. I said, where do we take the statement of Ibn Mas'ud? He just said, there's not an ayah that came down. And Ibn Mas'ud died before Ibn Abbas. And he said, no one knows the Quran more than I know every verse where it came down, who it came down, and when it came down. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said, yes, when Ibn Mas'ud was alive, Ibn Abbas was young. Huh? But Abdullah ibn Abbas lived 30 years after, and he gained more knowledge than Ibn Mas'ud had gained from the Quran. We all together. So Walid Ali, no one became like Ibn Abbas in the tafsir of the Quran. Are we together, brothers? Does that make sense? Abdullah ibn Abbas, the dua of the messenger got hold of him, which is Allahumma faqihu fi deen. Oh Allah, give this man Abdullah ibn Abbas what? Fiqh in the religion. Wa'allimhu ta'wil, and also teach him what? Teach him what? The interpretation of the Quran. ولذلك, what was the first thing Abdullah ibn Abbas took in when he was born? It was the Prophet's saliva, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His mother, what did she bring? She just brought him without having given him no breast milk, nothing, came out. And she came running to the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Prophet took some date, he placed it in his mouth, and then he rubbed that date, whatever, and he put it in the mouth of who? Ibn Abbas. And Ibn Abbas swallowed that. That was the first thing that went into his system. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. How old was he when the Prophet died? 13 and 15. Ibn Abbas was very young when the Prophet died. There's three views: 13, 15, or 17. Even let's say if he was 17, he's still young, right? Lakin Ibn Abbas did not sit down, meaning he traveled to meet all the companions to take the tafsir from them. To the extent one day, the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, he came to Umar. Umar was a man who was truly venerated, everybody's. Umar had haybah. You can't walk to Umar. People are scared of him. So for 1 year, Ibn Abbas was nervous to go to Umar radiallahu anhu, very nervous. For 1 year he's been, when should I approach him? No, not now. For a year. One day he got an opportunity. He got a bucket of water. He gave it to Abdullah Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar went to do his call of nature. And when he came back, Umar, he said, hold the bucket for me. And Umar was washing his hand. And he said to Ibn Abbas, Ibn Abbas, I have a question. For 1 year, wallahi, I was scared to ask you. And he asked Umar radiallahu anhu the question. What was the question? In tatuba ila Allahi faqad sagat qulubukuma. Who's these two Allah is talking to in this ayah? Look at what Umar said. Umar said to Ibn Abbas, wa ajaban laka ya Ibn Abbas. Fascination be for you, Ibn Abbas. Why is he fascinated with him? Because he respects him when it comes to the Quran. Umar knows the value of Abdullah ibn Abbas when it comes to the Quran. He said, you don't know these two? And then he said to him, no. And then he said to him, Hafsa and Aisha. The two here are being spoken about is who? And then, فَبَدَأَ يَسُوقُ الْحَدِيثِ. Then he went into the lengthy story. Umar told him a long story of what happened. The point is, the understanding of Ibn Abbas. He went and traveled. He went to Umar. He went to Uthman. He went to Zayd ibn Thabit. He went to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. He went to all of them. Took from them. He even once said to an Ansari man, come, let's go. Let's look for knowledge. Come, let's do this. The Ansari didn't have the aspiration that Abdullah ibn Abbas had. He said, look. Relax. Do you really think people are going to need you when the big companions are alive? So some people are going to do that to you. They're going to say to you, you're too old, man. Come on, relax. Take it easy. Or they're going to say to you, do you really think people are going to reach a time when they're going to need you? They're going to try to break your heart. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu didn't listen. He went, he asked, he questioned, he... Until what, brothers? Until one day the people came, all of them came, sitting under Ibn Abbas, and the Ansari man came and he saw him. And he said, إِنَّ هَذَا الْفَتَى أَعْقَلَ مِنِّي. That young boy, wallahi, he's more smarter than me. He was clever, wallahi. Look at him. You see? So people sometimes will tell you things, but don't listen to them. Put your head to it. Don't let them break your heart and say to you, you can't do it. So Ibn Abbas went, وَلِذَلِكَ, look at this, brothers. Look at this. Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, who is he? He's the father of who? Abdullah. He's the father of Abdullah ibn Abbas. He saw him, He saw his son Abdullah going with Umar. Umar saying, come with me. So he sat him down and said, Dad, Abdullah, Umar loves you. Umar is bringing you close. Don't let him down. Be noble. Be a righteous individual. Uphold what he thinks of you. And Abdullah ibn Abbas took that advice from his father and was very, to the extent one day, Umar said to him, brothers, I want you to, this is Ajib. He's a young boy, 15, 16, 17. And he brought him into the Majlis Shura. Shura is the gathering where the government and the constitution and the whole system, Umar is expanding an army to the world. And he's bringing a young 17, 16 into the gathering. To the extent, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, who's from the 10 promised Jannah, he said to Umar, this boy Ibn Abbas, he's the age of our children. Our children is the same age as him. He's sitting in a gathering with us. And we're talking about very deep, deep stuff. We're talking about serious stuff. This is not a, Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, I'll show you why I brought him into the gathering. Next day he said to him, Hayy ta'ala, everybody's sitting here, yes. And he told him, Hayy, the ayah, إذا جاء ماذا سورة إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفر إنه كان توابا. He said, what did you guys understand from this surah? All of them, they said that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was commanded to do istighfar and whatnot when he saw the people coming to Islam. And so, okay, what about you? They all said something. And then Umar said to رضي الله عنه, said to Abu Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas, what did you understand from this surah? What fiqh did you take from this surah? We all together. And then he said, what I took from this surah is that this surah was telling قُرْبُ أَجَلِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet was about to die. That's what it meant. The message behind that surah is that the Prophet's time is coming to an end. This is something that's lazim, necessitates. It's not mentioned in the surah. And he's young. And then Umar looked at him and he said to him, wallahi, what you've understood is what I understood from it as well. He looked at everyone else. No one brought that out of the surah. Are we all together, brothers? And that teaches us one thing, which is what? Inna Allah yarfa'u bihadha al-Qur'an aqwam. Allah, he raises people through this book. Wa yada'u bihi akharin. And another group of people, through this book, Allah puts them down. They go low. And another group of people, Allah puts them high up in the sky. Even if they're young, a father, his son will lead him in the salah if the son knows more Quran than his father. What's the matter? He would say, so straighten the line, dad. And he would lead him in the prayer. This issue does not hold. I'm bigger, I'm older, I'm more experienced than you. No. Anyone who knows the Quran more than you is greater and better than you. We're now going to quickly go over the tafsir of the tabi'een. Who are the tabi'een? Tabi'een is man laqiya al-sahabi. I mentioned the khulafa' al-arba'a, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ubay ibn Ka'b. Ubay ibn Ka'b and Zayd ibn Thabit. ولذلك, just as a benefit, Ibn Abbas from the Sahabas, if he says a view, does he take weight over everyone else? Yes. Ibn Abbas is tafsir, unless it's opposing an ayah or something else, he's got extra weight than the rest of the tafsir of any other companion. Are we all together, brothers? How Ibn Abbas is the highest. Ibn Abbas is what? The highest. And the students of Ibn Abbas are higher than the students of any other companion students. Like Mujahid ibn Jabrin, Tawus, ابن كيسان، سعيد ابن جبير. These are the students of Ibn Abbas and they have a greater weight. Are we all together? Pay attention. Now we're going to go to the tafsir of the tabi'in. Who are the tabi'in? The tabi'in are those who met the companions. Met. We don't say saw the companions because they could be blind. So we say met the companions. And they met the companions in what? In a state of iman. And they died upon Islam. What did they die upon? Islam. That's a companion. That's a tabi'i. What does it mean? Tafsir al-tabi'i. ما معنى تفسير التابعي? What does it mean, tafsir of a tabi'i? What does it actually mean? It means whatever has been transmitted to us from the tabi'in, in which they commented on in clarifying the verse. It's their fiqh. It's their, what they brought out of the verse. Here there's a question now, which brings us to the third one. We know now what the tafsir of tabi'i means. The third question is the tafsir of a tabi'i proof? Is it proof? We say the tafsir of the tabi'i without a shadow of a doubt, it's not equivalent to the tafsir of the sahabas. The sahabas is what? The sahabas is higher. But if the tafsir comes from Mujahid ibn Jabrin, who is he? Tabi'i, right? Mujahid ibn Jabrin. He's a what? He's a tabi'i. And he's from the students of what? Huh? Ibn Abbas. He's the one who said, عَرَثْتُ الْمُصْحَفَ مِصْحَفَ مَصْحَفَ. However you want to say it, three ways. It's a muthallath. You can say mushaf, mishaf, and mashaf. Three ways you can say it if you want to. It's like Jiddah, Jeddah, and Juddah. You can say it three ways. He said, عَرَثْتُ الْمُصْحَفَ. I presented the mushaf عَلَى ابْنَ Abbas. Ibn Abbas. أُوقِفُ عِنْدَ كُلِّ آيَةٍ. Every verse I stop him. Stop. What does this verse mean? Carry on. Stop. What does this verse mean? Every verse. Three times. From one side to the all through the whole Quran. And then again. And then again. Three times. Every single word and every single ayah Ibn Abbas explained it to him. This tabi'i is what? He's not. His view is strong. To the extent Sufyan al-Thawri said, إِذَا جَاءَكَ تَفْسِيرُ مُجَاهِدْ فَحَسْبُكَ بِهِ. If the tafsir of Mujahid comes to you, enough. Sufyan al-Thawri said that. Sufyan ibn Sa'id ibn Musruq al-Thawri. If it comes to you, the tafsir of Mujahid, say Alhamdulillah, just take it. Are we all together, brothers? That's important to understand that. There's another tabi'i by the name of Abu al-Jawza. Abu al-Jawza, he said, جَاوَرْتُ ابْنَ عَبَّاسِ اثْنَتَيْ عَشَرَ سَنَةً. I was neighbors with Ibn Abbas for 12 years. 12 years I was his neighbor. And I took the whole Quran from him. Whole entire Quran. Here we have to understand, if the tabi'i is known to take all of the tafsir from the sahabas, it has great weight. It has what? It's great weight. If the tabi'een all agree on the meaning of a verse, what does it become? Ijma'ah, we have to take it. If they differ amongst themselves and there's difference of opinion, then the difference is two types. اختلاف التنوع and اختلاف التضاد. Are we all together? اختلاف التنوع عن اختلاف التضاد. اختلاف التنوع عن اختلاف التضاد means what? The first one is اختلاف التنوع. difference in terms of, it's a difference that you can reconcile between the views. That's the first one. It's called ikhtilaf al-talawwu. It's a difference where you can reconcile between the two views. Tomato and tomato. Yeah, it's the same. Huh? It's like someone saying, oh, the cup is brown, and he's looking at this. And another one says, no, it's black, or dark brown, or black, and he looks at the lid. And another one says, it's green, and he looks at this. Everyone's talking about the same cup. Everyone just chose a part to pick. This we can reconcile it, no problem. We can reconcile. The second one is called اختلاف التضاد. اختلاف التضاد means what? One is saying black, one is saying white. Are we all together? One is saying right, one is saying left. It's called اختلاف التضاد. That can't be reconciled. There's no way to reconcile between this one. And this second type, اختلاف التضاد, it's not a lot in tafsir. The one that the majority of the times you come across in tafsir is اختلاف التلوع. Huh? I'm going to quickly write that. اختلاف التلوع. And the second one is called اختلاف التنوع and اختلاف التضاد. So اختلاف التنوع, what did I say? Tomato, tomato. You can reconcile between the two. Huh? The second one is what? Is اختلاف التضاد. تضاد means you can't reconcile between the views. The tabi'een and the sahabas, a lot of their tafsir is what? Huh? Talawwu. Are we all together, brothers? Like ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, oh Allah guide us to the straight path. No, another ayah, Allah says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةِ مِنَ اللَّهِ. No, sorry. Allah says in the ayah, وَلِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. Be happy with it. Huh? What is it that we need to be happy with? Some of the scholars, they said Quran. Some of them said the Prophet. Some of them said Islam. Some of them the Sunnah. Each one. Is that اختلاف التضاد or is it اختلاف التنوع? It's تنوع. You have to be pleased with all of that. Does that make sense? A lot of the times the tafsir is اختلاف التنوع. It's really something you can take all of them. Rarely do you come across tafsir that's what? تضاد. Tadad is like, for example, At-talaqu marratani. When it comes to this ayah, that divorce is two. Thalathata quru'. The qur'i in the ayah. Does it mean hayd? Or does it mean tuhr? Ikhtilafu tadad. Ikhtilafu tadad. Does the word qur', does it mean menstruation? Or does it mean what? Purification. This is what? You can't reconcile between that. It's different. But the overwhelming majority is what? Tanawwu. Alhamdulillah, we finished what we wanted to do today. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. Any questions? Before I take any of your questions, I just want to really say, brothers, number one, really, really take and give a lot of importance to all of this information. Please. It's for your own good. You have the whole week. If it was my choice, personally, I would have made this class every single morning. Sarahatan, I would have. But, insha'Allah Azza wa Jalla, Allah gave you guys the chances once a week. Once a week. Bil isbu'i marra. Ikhwah, you have 6 days. of a 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, 2 hours information, which on Sundays, the overwhelming majority of the times, Sunday the video is uploaded. You can go over it straight away. My advice to you brothers is, this knowledge is either going to be a proof for you or against you. Take it serious. This is not a lecture. It's not heart softening. There are other times and places for this. This is knowledge. Try to not be... Next time I'm going to do what I did today, randomly, ask you questions. Hey, Fadl, questions. Fadl. Fadl.
You know the Kulafiyah?
Yeah.
So there's three narrators between the...
The Prophet and the author.
So for example, can you give us one example of that?
Na'am. For example, Al-Imam Malik. He's, for example, Shafi'i, for example, he would say Malik Nafi' an Ibn Umar. And then the Prophet would be after that. So that's three. There's three people between the Prophet and the author. Second question. Which one? Qurtubi. Abu Abdullah al-Qurtubi is Ahkam. Who is the Mufassirin from the Tabi'een? So we have Mujahid, number one. We have Sa'id ibn Jubayr. We have Tawus ibn Kaysan. We have Dahaq ibn Mazahim. We have Abu Aliyat al-Rayahi. We have Qatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi. There's a lot of Tabi'een, Kuthur. We have Suddi. Suddi, now. Ayah, Fadal. Ayah, Fadal.
Do we have a doctor in our class of
we're going to be doing that next week. We're going to talk about the different tafsir books. Tafsir Mujarir al-Tabari and the different publications for it, and Tafsir al-Abi Hatim, Tafsir al-Muharrar by Ibn Atiyah. We're going to speak about that in great details, inshaAllah ta'ala. And is Ibn Kathir's Tafsir a summary of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari as commonly people think it is? We'll discuss that.
Which is the best tahqiq of Khalq al-Fa'il al-Abad?
The best one is the tahqiq of Fahd al-Fuhayd. Fadal.
The question I was asking him, yeah, regarding the five scholars, why was it Ibn Majah asked
them? You see, when the question was asked, the person didn't mention Ibn Majah, like when he answered it, he added Ibn Majah to it, Ibn Taymiyyah. Maybe Nisyan or whatnot. Like in the real reason why some of the scholars always didn't mention Ibn Majah is because I think we mentioned it. Ibn Majah was later added into the Ummahat al-Sittah. There was always a dispute whether Ibn Majah or Ahmad ibn Hanbal or Muwatta al-Imam Malik or Abu Dawud al-Tayalisi, and others were pushing other people in there. Ibn Majah is, it falls under the Muttabi'. None of them are Muqallideen. None of them are blind followers, no. With the neighbor who neighbored Ibn Abbas for 12 years was Abu al-Jawza, Rabi'i ibn something like that. Abu al-Jawza Rabi'i. His name is Abu al-Jawza Rabi'i. Hey, any other questions? Ha, Fadl. Ikhtilafu? No, if it's tadad, they're opposing each other, you look at who's the closest to the evidence. I mean, if there's ikhtilaf or tanawu', there's really not ikhtilaf, they're all together, so that's no problem. But if there's ikhtilaf or tadad, you look at who is more closer to the evidence. That's when we do tarjih of. It's when there is no ayah to explain it, and there's no hadith to explain it, or there's no aqwal al-sahaba. The sahaba haven't said anything, or the tabi'een haven't said anything. The fifth, we go to the language. The fifth, we look at what? We look at the Arabic language based on what it means. And where did he do it? Ha. Is it ijtihadi? Now this is, it was a waqa'ah that they saw when Surah Al-Tahrim, you mean, right? Oh, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ. Ha, that's ijtihad. Ha, this is, okay, this is based on dalalat. The dalala here is what? Dalalatul mutabaqa, dalalatul tadammun, and dalalatul iltizam. It is there, but it's a dalala which is far-fetched in his ijtihad thinking. It necessitates it. Are you with me? Do you know dalalatul iltizam? For example, if I say, this masjid. When I say masjid, what comes to your mind? No, a carpet, a wall, roof. Of course, a minaret comes to your mind. I didn't say that. A door comes to your mind. Locks come to your mind. Sah. Microphone comes to your mind. Sahih. Because that's dalalatu mutabaqa. With all of that in it is what the masjid is. Good. Tadammun means when I take part of that and I say window. I've taken a part of the house. I'm at a part of the masjid. Dalalatu iltizam means if there's a masjid, then somebody must have made it, right? Sah. Somebody must have made the masjid. That's iltizam. It's nothing to do with the masjid. It's just external point that you would automatically know is in place. Sah? So some of the words of the Quran are like that. I'll give an example. Allah says in the Quran, Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawati wa min al-ardi mithlahunna yatanazzalu al-amru baynahunna lita'lamu anna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir wa anna Allah qad ahata bi kulli shay'in ilma. Allah creates, right? Does He not create? I automatically know. If Allah is a creator, He has to have the what? The knowledge, and He has to have the will. I got those two by iltizam. You know why? Creating, to know how to create is not enough. That's just one portion. The other one is that you want to create. Sahih. Are we together, brothers? That's what Allah says in the ayah. Allahu alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawati wa min al-ardi mithlahunna yatanazzalu al-amru baynahunna lita'lamu anna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. Qudra came here because khalq was mentioned. Wa anna Allah qad ahata bi kulli shay'in. If you want to create, you have to have two things. You have to have the ability and the wish and the will. Sahih? Let's say I can make an iPhone, but I don't want to. What about if I want to make an iPhone, but I don't have the ability to? Sahih? So I need these two. These two necessitated from being able to be one who creates. Does that make sense? That's the dalalatul iltizam. So the Sahabas had that knowledge. And we mentioned it last time, remember, when we mentioned the concept of the woman who was brought to Uthman ibn Affan, who is accused of zina. How did they bring that? That's called dalalatul ishara. It was necessitated from the ayah. They had that, the Sahabas had that. That's ijtihad that they would do. And it is based on the language, but it's a far-fetched. No. The door of ijtihad is not locked. We have mustajaddat, we have contemporary issues happening that require to be brought back to. To what? To an ayah. New things are happening. We're seeing new things nowadays. Sahih. Are you allowed to harm a Muslim? Huh? Are you? But the time of the Prophet, what was the harming? Physical. I'm a verbal, right? What about if I harm a person over the internet? And I said, this was not what the Prophet was talking about. Huh? You're going to say, you're going to use a qa'ida which is الضرر يزال. صحيح. For internet, that's a nazila, that's a contemporary issue that hasn't been at the time of the Prophet. صح. So the tafsir of the ayat sometimes need to be applied to contemporary issues to show that the ayat still are working, still functioning. Does that make sense? So ijtihad has to be done to show you that tafsir is needed. Why did Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti come and do tafsir of the Quran when there's thousands of mufassirin who already done tafsir? Huh? The scholars, they believe a qa'ida, which is what? Kam taraka al-awwalu lil-akhir. How much has the early one left for the later one? Then after Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, Abdurrahman al-Nasir al-Sa'di came and he done tafsir again. Are we all together, students? I mean, whoever from both of them came first. But that just shows, and today people are doing, Ibn Uthaymeen came, he didn't say, oh, my teacher done tafsir, so I don't need to mention, he did tafsir, say Ibn Uthaymeen. وَهَكَذَا. Everyone's doing tafsir, it's carrying on. Does that make sense?
You know the Muqtabi, does he have to do Iqtada based on one set of usul, so like he does taqlid in usul for a particular madhab, for example, but then he does taraji.
The mutabi' has to go through darajatul taqlid first of all. He has to follow madhab, as the madhab days, and he follows that. And then when he finishes that, then he becomes a mutabi'. And then after being a mutabi', then he moves on to ijtihad. He's never any of them two at the same time.
But when he's doing it to them, when it comes to the actual usul, is he doing it around the usul and the furu'?
Ah, so each madhab has their different what? Usul. The asl itself is being done tarjih on. So the person, he's a muttabi', he's going to reject a asl based on madhab al-Shafi'i and say, this asl is wrong. This asl is a what? This usul Shafi'i believe is wrong. Like for example, Al-Imam Malik believes the qawl Ahl Medina is a what? It's a hujjah. A person is a Maliki, all his life he's been accepting that. Now he might do tarjih and say, I don't believe that. I believe the Sahaba, umuman, wherever they are in the world, their speech is hujjah. Are we all together? So he may go against that. Are we all together, brothers? وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. It can happen now. Furu' and usul, a person will do itiba', he will go against it. Like in the mujtahid, he may even make a asl. The mujtahid. He makes his own asl. He's reached that level. He just cannot go against ijma', and he can't go against the nas. Does that make sense? Last question. لا. A muqallid cannot follow a muttabi'. A muqallid has to follow a mujtahid. And it's not enough that he follows a person of knowledge only. Pay attention to this. The poet, he said, وَلَيْسَ فِي فَتْوَاهُ مُفْتٍ مُتَّبِعٍ. It's not enough that you follow a scholar in his fatwa. What does he have to have? He has to have wara' with his ilm. To be a person who's known with, not just he has knowledge. He has to have a person who is right. He eats halal. He watches what he says. His actions are in accordance to his knowledge. It's a lot of conditions. It's not just any individual. That's what person follows. Here's the question. Does he stick to that person? Or does he go to him some issues and he can go to issues with somebody else? And what's the line between tatabbu' al-rukhas and this? There's a lot of discussions behind that. We don't want to go into that. But lakin, if a person is a blind follower, let him just blind follow one person and take his fatwa. Later he'll find out if he's right or he's wrong, because Allah said in the ayah, what did he say? فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرِي إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُوا. وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ.